alive. We are the luckiest generation to see God face to face. Rejoice in the Olumba has come to reign. We are lucky generation. Rejoice.
The money is rising in the name of Jesus. The head of the crown is a cross.
The more we talk about Jesus and how near I am, the better for me. Jesus, he saved me from my sin, my wrong. He's changed my life.
Ladies and gentlemen, I'd like to start as I usually do by welcoming you to Speaker's Corner, London. This has long been a place of freedom of speech, a place to come and get things off your chest. As I go around Speaker's Corner, my concern is the human beings will get beyond these religious divisions. Of course, there are many, many things which divide humanity. Religion's only one of them. We don't share a common ancestor with the chimpanzee. We are genetically engineered hybrids. And we're here as a kind of experiment to see how we can live together, come together, and hopefully become one organism, humanity. And in our humanity, we find our true nature. And of course, compassion is important. Compassion for the other aspects of creation, including most especially the ones closest to us. How is it that science, which tries to say that we're an evolved monkey, or we share a common ancestor with a chimpanzee? How is it the same science can be indifferent to a relatively intelligent being, a relatively sensitive creature, such as a rhesus monkey in their science labs? Why is it these same scientists are indifferent to the plight of rhesus monkeys in laboratories, having all sorts of horrendous procedures, torments, tortures, sentient beings who cannot express what's happening to them in language as we're able to do? But it's clear from the little expressions and the faces and the body antics and so forth, let alone the psychological damage as they scamper about in the cages, that they're clearly being harmed. Now, science would reduce us to an animal that can be used, utilized. And they decide, indeed in Nazi Germany, they are scientists, every bit as scientific as any scientist here, scientists to decide who should live and who should die. And that program is called eugenics. And eugenics was practiced in Sweden successfully. It's financed by the Harriman family, United States of America. Adolf Hitler didn't invent eugenics, and alas, he's not the last proponent of it. There's a phrase they have. The Darwinists and the Neo-Darwinists, they talk about useless eaters. That would only harm and damage humanity and its evolution. You notice I use the word evolution, but not in a Darwinian sense. What is evolving is our spirituality. And part of that is our concern for other creatures, other parts of nature, of God's creation, which we call lower life forms. We can learn from many, many aspects of nature. And of course, we can learn best from looking at our own members and our own numbers. And we here at Speaker's Corner, we're lucky we're not undergoing the serious, painful lessons of the people in Syria or the people in other parts of the world that are afflicted, such as the Ukraine. I must say, the heir to the throne, Prince Charles, I felt it was irresponsible and unreasonable for him to compare Vladimir Putin to the Austrian monster, Adolf Hitler. I understand that Prince Charles in Canada, one of his many expensive trips, would want to give comfort to a Jewish lady there because there had been in circulation apparently in the Ukraine or in Crimea a letter telling the Jewish people to get out, to leave, to evacuate. But a brave rabbi came forward and said the letter was fake. Of course it was fake.
Are you sure?
Yes, of course it is.
Why was it wrong for Prince Charles to say what he said?
It was wrong because the difference between, say, Vladimir Putin, right? If Vladimir Putin really resembled Adolf Hitler...
No, that's not the point. He never said he was Hitler, did he? What did he say?
What Prince Charles was speaking to the lady about, the reporter coerced her into her conversation. And she repeated to him, and it's only hearsay, because only we haven't heard Prince Charles' side, he said, isn't that what's happening in Ukraine with Putin? Now, he never compared Hitler. He never said Hitler is exactly the same as Putin. He says, isn't that the same as what's happening with Putin in Ukraine?
The same as what?
What happened with Hitler. He never said Hitler.
That's a comparison.
No.
The first thing I want to say, you mind if I exercise my freedom of speech?
Please do.
Right. The first thing I want to say is that lady, that Jewish lady, was very indiscreet, would you agree, that when she was telling the reporter what was supposed to be a private conversation between her and the English heir, Prince Charles, right? The point I want to make, and it's an important one, that if in any way Vladimir Putin resembled Adolf Hitler, Vladimir Putin would have overrun Ukraine, burned all the towns and villages before Barack Obama had finished a round of golf. That's what Hitler would have done. So the parallels, there is a parallel there, and I've spoken about it before, which is that Vladimir Putin moved up some armed forces on the basis that he was protecting the Russian-speaking people in the East, just as Hitler had done with Sudetenland. So there is an historical parallel, and I recognise that. But I think what had alarmed the Jewish lady, and I do commend and understand why Charles, he's a man of compassionate man, why he wanted allay her fears. It's this circulation, this letter in circulation, you know, threatening a kind of pogrom of Jewish people. The letter's fake. There's no such move there's no such idea to move Jewish people out of anywhere. I mean, Putin, I think, is one of the finest political leaders in the world right now. I really do. I can't think of anyone better. I mentioned Barack earlier. I mean, Barack's been a huge disappointment. Former president of Iran, Ahmadinejad, said Barack Obama has been a big disappointment. I mean, you know, he got a Nobel Peace Prize, Barack, but that was for rhetoric. I hope they never again give out a prize for rhetoric. You've got to go not by what someone says or what they preach, but what they actually do. I mean, if you look at the drone strikes and how reckless they are. Now, I've considered as a conspiracy theorist that the military want to put Obama in the shit. The military are actually doing these things because Obama is the commander-in-chief. He carries the can. He gets the blame. You see, I mean, it's possible. I read a piece by Gordon Duff on Veterans Today, which I recommend. And Gordon Duff said that when they saw Obama coming, he was elected, they set up, this is the Bush gang, they set up parallel structures. And it's well possible that Obama doesn't even know these things are happening, that there's other things going on. Because certainly I've said again before, I'll say it again, the resentment and the hatred towards Barack Obama, if you combine the hatred towards the Democrat, Bill Clinton, and the hatred towards the Republican, George W. Bush, and you add them together, it still doesn't equate to the hate resentment against Barack Obama. I mean, they say he's Kenyan, for example. Well, that's a good definition of an African-American. In fact, then they say his mother was white, and she was, they say she was in the CIA, and that was maybe what she was doing in Indonesia, maybe. But I think it's a good thing that Barack went to a madrasa, to a Muslim school, given how Islam is militant in the world. And I can't blame Islam for being militant, given all the clash of civilizations that the Harvard academic, the late Samuel Huntington, talked and wrote about. Tony Blair, that liar, he says, oh, there's no clash of civilizations. How is it then it's all Islamic countries that were attacking?
Was there Muslims out in Bosnia? They're not your normal looking, sorry if I'm stereotyping.
No, I know what you're saying, I understand.
That is the view of an everyday, that is the view of my 11-year-old daughter of a Muslim. But what she wouldn't get is my perspective of what a Muslim looks like when I served out in the UN out in Bosnia.
Whose army were you in?
Her Majesty's the Queen's.
Right, okay. But you as a... You, you having sworn an oath to serve Her Majesty.
And the Queen, and God.
It was effectively her that invaded Iraq, wasn't it?
Yes.
Yes. On a tissue of lies. Afghanistan's about heroin and oil.
Yes, it is.
It's about heroin and oil. There's an oil pipeline. The Taliban were signatories to a pipeline deal in 2001.
Tell you what, we should invade Ukraine. What about all the gas that's going?
They pulled out of it, right? Well, I mean, how do you? How long are you out there? You're no longer a soldier, right?
I'm out now. I did 15 years. I was born into it as well. So really,
your family and all that.
My mum's still a serving officer. My brother's just done his 22.
Okay.
So we're right.
Well, how do you see Vladimir Putin? I'd like to get your perception. Judy Gibbs,
truthfully, yeah. But as any politician, he has his good sides, he has his bad sides.
What's his good side?
I fully agree, he's looking after his people.
And that's a good thing?
Yeah, of course it is.
I agree.
Well, why not?
All right.
That's like us going to somewhere, if we had a colony of British people out somewhere, we'd go, we need to keep an eye on them. But he's also, pardon the pun, stirring up the hornet's nest by pushing people in that we all know that he's funding.
What do you think the Americans are doing there?
With what? What proof have we got the Americans are there?
Have you heard of Academy?
No.
Blackwater?
No. Oh, Blackwater, the security system.
Academy, they're now called.
Where are they on the news?
Now, those are ex-special forces psychopaths, aren't they?
Well, what's the word psychopath? For what reason?
Psychopath, someone who is doesn't feel any remorse or guilt or emotion when they kill. My uncles, my father, my grandfathers, they were in conflicts as well, all right?
We're going different
route. All right, so we've all been touched by these things. But if we keep going on and wars and crusades for oil and all the rest of it, then we'll never have peace on this earth.
No, we won't.
You see?
We're
and right. I want to see a peaceful world.
We've got to stop.
But we're all one organism.
Oh, no, I fully agree. But then...
You know that the Queen's a multi-trillionaire, don't you? Multi-trillionaire.
I have no problems with that.
You have no problems with that.
Of course not.
But you see all the poverty and the lack in the world, but you see this one woman living in opulence and luxury. Her son Charles, we talked with Charles and the Jewish lady in Canada, right? Her son Charles has a bloke to squeeze out his toothpaste on his... on his brush. He has his shoelaces ironed. You're laughing at that.
Do you know what? So,
you think that's great. You would serve that with a gun, and you think that's... You're holding something good.
But the point is...
Sorry, mate. I couldn't do that.
I don't think
I'd say iron your own shoelaces, mate.
How do you know he's got someone that irons his shoelaces?
It's well known. The people...
Why is it how known?
Well, because people let things out. We know all sorts of stuff.
Who?
Now, I'd interested to get your view. Which regiment are you in?
Pardon?
Which regiment are you in?
Royal Army Medical Corps.
Royal Army Medical Corps, right, very good. Okay, now, as a former member of the Royal Army Medical Corps, did you ever have interactions with the enemy?
Of course, yeah.
Who was your enemy there?
Well, I take a pick of a list.
Aye.
Serbians, Muslims, Croats.
Right.
Well, no, not really. The UN...
But you notice that you and your comrades, you're in their country, they're not in your country.
Absolutely.
Yeah. But anyway, did you attend with your medical skills to the enemy? That's good. That's humane, isn't it?
Do you know who the people that were the most unappreciative?
Probably the people whose mum you killed last week drone strike.
Drone strikes weren't happening then in Bosnia.
No, it's a more recent technology. The Americans are using it somewhat liberally, don't you think?
Right. If you want to know, right, out there, do you know what the process of the UN peacekeeping role in Bosnia? Do you know what it was?
Well, I know the official. I mean, I can imagine you're going to give me the line. But there's always an economic motive,
right?
I've told you. I'm amazed that you, as a former member serving the Queen, you didn't realise Afghanistan's about oil and heroin, two lucrative commodities.
What did you think it was?
Pardon?
What did he think it was?
Who, me?
Afghanistan.
I've got no view on that.
I mean, when they went into there, I read before America and we went in that the Taliban had wiped out virtually the production of opium.
That's correct.
I read
that
in a reputable newspaper.
Yeah.
And as soon as the Yanks got there, again I read, and even now to this day, they are the main producers of bloody opium. So who were the goodies and who were the baddies?
Who said that?
Do you remember before you guys were there, the Soviets were there, in Afghanistan, the Mujahideen. We're like the Mujahideen, we don't like the Taliban. But the Taliban are the sons of the Mujahideen, right? Now, do you know what? You know why Gorbachev stopped the war and pulled the troops out of Afghanistan?
Please tell me.
I'll tell you. Because a single member of the Russian Special Forces, a member of Spetsnaz, he defected to the Mujahideen and he taught the tribesmen how to knock out Russian helicopter gunships using American Stinger missiles smuggled through Pakistan. When that happened, Gorbachev thought the game's over. I mean, But can you imagine, remember, the SAS defecting and fighting the you know, to the enemy, so called? That would be special, almost unique. Now, as a former member of the Royal Army Medical Corps, I'd like to get your. What do you think happened to Diana that night in that tunnel in Paris? Was that an accident or what?
We all have a conspiracy theory, don't we? Anything could be a conspiracy.
Anything.
Theory. Anything could be a conspiracy. There's always a conspiracy about something.
Well, that you see. I'm visiting professor of conspiracy theory speakers corner, by the way.
Right.
So I know about this subject very well. But it's interesting when I asked you about what happened to Diana. I never used the phrase conspiracy theory, you did. I asked if you thought it was an accident. So I kind of gave you the or what. The or what was kind of vague, right? But you went to conspiracy theory, so I mean.
No, hang on a minute. No. That's a twist of the words.
Not really.
Okay then.
That's what happened.
Was it a hell of an unfortunate accident?
Convenient.
You can use the word "unfortunate accident."
This gentleman here said convenient. You see, real accidents have enormous amounts of inconvenience. You know, they just do. They happen at the wrong time, the wrong people. Cause all sorts of problems, right? This accident, in quotes, this accident in Paris is the opposite. It's incredibly convenient.
Was Dodie fired? That could have been seen good.
Dodie's a nickname. He's in the film business. Like
whatever the name was. Yeah. That's all we know. Dodie fired, it wouldn't look good as the
Dodie end. Means you take it apart. It's D-O-D-I. If you take it apart, it's do die. Do you see that?
Oh, that's convenient, isn't it?
Do die.
Yeah.
Lady die, lady die, lady die, princess die, princess die, princess die. Well, the accident, so-called, was very well engineered. And in fact, last year it came out because there was... A couple of the SAS guys will take the court, drag through the court system, because they got a little Glock for themselves and 300 rounds of ammo. Sergeant Danny Nightingale.
Ah,
300
yes.
rounds, including hollow point ammo, right? I don't even know these things, I'm just repeating things I read. You actually know them better than me, you've seen the effects of them, right? But I thought, well, why are they taking these heroes through the dragging through the courts and everything? Well, because they're scared that they might do a kind of a Jill Dando on the side.
No, they're not. Because the rules in the military is, you are not, all weapons have to be accounted for, regardless of who you are. All ammunition has to be accounted for.
Given this as a gift. This was a gift from somewhere.
No. The rounds weren't.
They were army.
Yeah, they were army issues.
So our army uses hollow point ammo.
Yeah. So it depends what you're doing.
You're trying to blow somebody's head apart.
Why do we have special forces? Why do we just have your normal infantry? Well, they're going to be doing different things.
Well.
But what he had, the gun, they didn't do it for. What they did it for was the ammunition that he said he never had.
People bleed to death the same way, whether they're special or whatever they are.
A lot quicker, though.
Right. So the thing is that... there's another guy, a colleague of his, who was a prosecution witness. And we never found out his name. Maybe you met the guy, you know him personally. They just call him Soldier N. Have you heard of Soldier N?
Soldier N.
No, he's Soldier N. No, S or R. They're other guys. He's Soldier N. And Soldier N was a prosecution witness against his comrade, Sergeant
Nightingale.
And Nightingales sing like canaries sometimes. At his second court-martial, he decided to play hardball, and this got in the media, that apparently Soldier N's wife, well, it's not apparent, it's well established, the police have checked it out, Soldier N's wife sent letters to various people, because her husband was training heir at the throne, and I hope the next king, William the Fifth, was training William the Fifth, Prince William, in advanced driving techniques, because he might be caught in an ambush, and might need to evade whoever, right? And his wife, being a tender creature, felt sorry for the prince, having lost his mother at the age of 15. And Soldier N did something he maybe shouldn't have done. I don't mean by the law of God, which of course all these fuckers do, but I mean he told his missus that in fact the regiment were involved in the murder of Diana, Princess of Wales. They killed her, right? That crash was engineered to look like an accident. It wasn't a real one. So the gentleman said it was too convenient. I mean, an underpass. Mercedes are generally fairly safe cars. The people who build the car, Daimler Benz, they weren't allowed to inspect the whole machine to see what might have gone wrong mechanically or electronically. It turns out the car was actually stolen a few months before by people dressed as Arabs, and the car was electronically rewired. So it was well planned and so forth. But Diana was, she said she wasn't a political figure, but she was involved in Landmines. See, you must have seen landmine. You must have done
seen the effects of landmine.
And you match what I'm saying. So, see, Dana, maybe you can you're able to deal with this in a kind of objective medical way. But see, her tender heart. She saw these little boys of 15 have their legs blown off, going out to play football and maimed for life, and she thought this is wrong. And I remember Nicholas Soames MP, a friend of Charlie Boy.
Said she was mentally unstable.
Yeah, she was in advanced stages of paranoia. Yeah. And Earl Howe said that it was she was a loose cannon. And that was a real, I realise now that was a bad sign, that the word cannon. And in fact, at the end, they dragged the body, the mortal remains, along the streets of London on a gun carriage, which I thought was wildly inappropriate, and I signed a petition to that effect.
Why was it inappropriate?
Because a woman who's campaigning against landmines and obviously threatening the property, it's a shame that my country, this is my country as much as your mate, you mean? And if some horde was coming over the White Cliffs of Dover, I'd be at your side, right? But I don't want to go on some foreign land in the tissue of lies when it's really about oil and heroin. I mean, you're your research mate. Afghanistan is about heroin. Okay. We don't have a free press, we've got D notices. I mean, and the truth about Diana's murder has to come out. We can't keep it suppressed.
It's Uno, well, an apparent suicide. Was it a photographer or a journalist?
It wasn't actually Fiat Uno, it was another car. Yeah. But he owned that Fiat Uno. He was a very famous paparazzo called James Andelson.
Right.
And 2.5 years later, millennium year, 2000, he was found in a piece of spare ground.
Yes.
And he's supposed to have locked himself in this other car, I think it was a Renault.
Yes.
He locked himself in the car and supposed to burn himself to death.
That's right.
But an attending firefighter, a man called Jean-Christophe Pila, yes, very brave guy to come forward, all very foolish. Most people have to keep their mouth shut, but he came forward, he said that, you know, one of the first things if your hair burns off, right? He said on the skull, there were bullet holes in the man's skull.
Shot first.
And then made it look. But the people have tried to think about how you would actually kill yourself in that way, and it doesn't add up. The keys went in the... Where's the keys? I mean, you know, is he supposed to have thrown the keys away and it would have been found, and then wind up the window so he can... I mean, the whole thing's absurd. But it's the idea is to frighten anyone else coming forward, anyone blowing the whistle. And the police report, which of course has been laughed at, but the police spent a lot of time and money. But in fact, the guy in charge of that police report, whose name I used to remember, and no, but his offices were broken into by MI5 and stole his laptop. So when you get MI5 squeezing the coppers, you know where your pegs is coming from. I mean, you've got to play ball. So, of course, those reports, you know, said, well, that man, they said Anderson was never there, even though Anderson boasted he was there. And that famous picture of you get the bodyguard, now he survived because he was wearing the seatbelt, which itself is odd, because apart from the bodyguard's the one that's not supposed to have a seatbelt on, so he could quickly spring out and get his gun and everything.
Quickly manoeuvre.
They use the door as a shield and everything else. So that was very odd. But the bodyguard survived, but guess what? He's got amnesia. See, he can't remember anything. Isn't that amazing, you know? But at the inquest in 2008, at the inquest at the Royal Courts of Justice, laughingly called Justice, one of the witnesses described a conversation that she had getting into a lift, something very ordinary, everyday event, getting into an elevator with Trevor Rees-Jones. And he said that he was scared to remember in case they would kill him. He made that remark to her and she reported that as what he said. So, you know,
shocking,
isn't it? Now, a man who was discredited and intimidated was Richard Thomason. Richard Thomason's ex-SAS, ex-MI6, he came forward he said he saw a plan at MI6, supposedly to kill Milosevic in exactly that manner in Geneva. So if you score out Milosevic and put in Diana, score out Geneva and put in Paris, that's it. But the normal pen stopped him from coming forward, but Thomason signed a sworn affidavit, a legal document to this effect. He also said that, Thomason? Yeah, he said that one of the two bodyguards at the Al-Fayed hired, either Kez Wingfield or Trevor Rees-Jones, is an MI6 asset. So they had a guy in the inside all the time. You see what I mean? Diana was just, as Earl Howe said, a loose cannon. What's she going to do next? I mean, they were frightened of what she was about. Like, and now a lot of the conspiracy theorists believe that Diana had stuff on the royal family's own works, can we call it that? I mean, Prince Charles is... I'm not saying anything wasn't in the Sunday Times. Prince Charles was caught in bed with a bloke. I mean, I'm very broad-minded myself. I don't mind, you know what I mean? Why not? You know what I mean? That the guy that was took the breakfast in, he told Anna that. She recorded that on these tapes, the cassette tapes, which were called Laughing the Crown Jewels. They had the security services search high and low to find the Crown Jewels, these tapes that Dan had recorded, which this was poor creature. She was trying to get some dirt in the walls that she could use as leverage, because she didn't want to lose access to her precious boys, William and Harry. That was the biggest fear, yeah, that she wouldn't have access to William and Harry. Of course, with her being murdered, then of course the Windsor gang have total control. The punditocracy say that because Diana came from a broken home, that she wanted more than anything a little kind of mummy and daddy and happy family.
She wanted a nuclear family when it's never been done before.
No, it hasn't actually. It's not part of their culture. So she was just bucking the trend there as well. In so many ways, she was a breath of fresh air. Doesn't begin to describe Diana, you know. She's like a beautiful rainbow in the sky, you know. But they murdered that girl, make no mistake about it, you know what I mean? Made it look like an accident. And I thought it was amazing that Soldier Wren's wife, she's in fear of her own safety, her name's Sarah. Sarah, they've called her. She let it out that her husband told her the SAS were involved, and who else is going to do the gig? And the husband, of course, he said, look, it's just a job. An order's an order. But what's really interesting is Soldier Wren told his missus that the orders came from the Royal Inner Circle. It's very dangerous to make the world more violent by selling these gizmos and implements. Why can't we be like the Japanese and build amplifiers and camcorders and sell all that stuff? I mean, what's better for the world, camcorders or landmines? It's got to be camcorders, I mean. And these mines, of course, they're in the ground for years afterwards. A little kid's going out to play. And this is the kind of thing that used to upset the tender heart of Princess Diana. And I hope, ladies and gentlemen, you always come from your heart, because that's where you really reside. And they talk about Jesus, but they're really alluding to Christ, and that's where Christ resides in you, ladies and gentlemen, in your own heart. Always follow your conscience. Don't follow parties, don't follow leaders, don't follow folks with me with big gobs. Follow your own heart. Thank you for listening, and God bless you all.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
There's nobody else to listen to now.
No,
it's all the Muslim and the Christian.
Thanks, Judy.
Glasgow is very nice.